this is Black History Month, and what the administration wanted to do this year was to make this a little bit beyond just the one big performance. We wanted you to be able to take something away from a very meaningful series of educational opportunities. And as Malcolm once said, of all of our studies, history is best qualified to reward our research. So with that in mind, I have our special genealogist and historian, Percy E. White III, creator of FindFamilyRoots.com. Initially created a website to memorialize his father and grandfather. White, who is a resident of Waldorf, Maryland, now uses his website to not only document his own family history, but to assist others in researching and sharing their family histories, and to tell the stories of familiar and not well-known people, places, and events in African American history. Without further ado, Percy E. White.
Thank you, Mr. Shabazz, and I thank the principal. I thank all of you for allowing me to come and speak with you today. Now, this is the thing. Before we get started, I got to make sure we're all clear on some of the terms that are used. Somebody tell me what genealogy is. If you don't know, it's okay.
Basically, it's tracing back your family tree, like where you come from, like what different family extensions you have.
Bingo. Absolutely. So genealogy is the study of one's own history, of others' family history, tracing it back. So that's what genealogy is. Now, before I get too far involved in my talk, I want to give you a little personal information. As Mr. Shabazz told you, my name is Percy White. I work right down the street. I'm a juvenile probation officer for the city of Alexandria. But that's not why I'm here today. I'm here today to share with you some information about African American history and tracing your family roots from genealogy. I grew up just across the bridge, Oxon Hill, Maryland. That's where I live. Went to school locally, right across the street, the bridge. My parents worked two jobs each because they wanted to make sure I had an opportunity to have a great education. So they sent me to a private school, the Baptist Catholic High School. I had a tool I could use. That's why they sent me there. They wanted me to take full advantage of the tool I had. That tool I had at the time was the ability to play basketball. So one of the staff at the Mather High School told my parents, look, you can either pay for his high school or you can pay for his college. Which one do you think they chose to do?
High school.
Yes, sir. They chose to pay for high school. College was way, way more expensive. They both worked two jobs so I could go to that high school. Now, I used that tool playing basketball to open doors that I never even knew existed. When I got to college, I minored in African American history, and I majored in speech communications. My point for telling y'all any of this, all of this, is just to say anything that I have done that you may see, all of you can do more and well beyond. That's why it's important to study even in those classes that you don't like. You have no idea what doors are going to open for you down the line. The question would be, how prepared are you? I could not stand writing when I left high school, but I ended up catching a little interest in something and I majored in speech communication. The door is open. Okay, so on to what I'm here to talk about. And also, as I talk, I want this to be a conversation. I don't want y'all to just sit there and not raise your hand, ask questions, make comments, so please be involved in this. Black History Month is a time for us to remember and celebrate people of African American heritage who, in spite of the odds, were determined to make a better life for themselves, their families, and all of us. With that in mind, my link into tracing my family roots began with my father. Mr. Shabazz, can I get you to scroll up? Yes, you can keep going. And click on About Us. My father, Percy L. White Jr., is my hero. Scroll down just a little bit, please. Mm-hmm, you keep going. And then we'll go back up in a minute. Mm-hmm, you keep going. Mm-hmm, yes, that's my father. Throughout my life, he told me stories related to African-American history, and he told me family history stories. He interwove them and connected them like threads in a cloth. And that cloth just kept growing. So he would tell me about our family history. For example, my father was 5'9". I told this already. I'm 6'7". So people say, Percy, where did you get your height from? Your father was 5'9", you're 6'7". This gentleman, Percy White Sr., was 6'9". Very tall gentleman, especially since he was born in 1900. So when he was in his 20s and 30s, 1920, 1930, this is a 6'9 man walking around Richmond, Virginia. I imagine he stood out a great deal. Scroll back up, please. So the link for me, and I want it to be for you, you have to find your link which carries you, which ignites your interest to go back and trace your family history. And I hope I can be a part of creating that little spark. My father, he looked for his father's, let me say this again, excuse me. My father, his father's grave is here. When his father died, he was 18 years old. This is a black cemetery in Richmond, Virginia. Over the years, the cemetery grew up and it became, it wasn't maintained. So when my father, as an older man, went back to try to locate the grave of his father, he couldn't find him. When my father died February 26th of 2000, having never found that grave, that became my mission. So I researched records, I talked to my family members, and I found that at Woodlawn Cemetery, Percy White Sr., again, was born there. Was buried there. I spoke to Mr. Ensminger, the cemetery manager. He actually had the original records on this flimsy piece of paper of everyone that was buried there. Once I found that out, I purchased the marker and I placed it there for Percy White Sr. So again, my father could never find his father's, where his father was buried. He died without doing that. My mission became finding that, because that meant a lot to me. And I placed that marker there. What will be your connection? What will be your connection to your background, to your history? Our first heroes are often our family members. For those from whom we descend, researching our family history gives us an idea of how our family lived 100, 150, 200 years ago, sometimes even more. Now, I'm going to give you an itemized list of what you can do to start researching your family history. Again, if you have questions, jump in. Comments, questions, anything. When you begin your search with family history, it's important that you document what you already know. For example, who are your parents? Who are your grandparents? Who are your great-grandparents? How many of you in here know your great-grandparents' names on both sides? Okay, a few people. If your grandparents or great-grandparents are still living, if you don't talk to them and find out what their life was like, who their relatives were, you're going to let a library of information leave you without gaining that information. Does that make sense? I am very fortunate. My mother's mother, Miss Viola Mayfield, this coming April, she will be 102 years old. Now, you ask her what happened yesterday, she couldn't tell you. But you ask her about her childhood, she can go right down the list, still tell you relatives, how she grew up, and so forth. Don't let that information get away from you. So again, document what you already know about your family history. Keep records of what, when, where, how. For example, if you speak to your grandmother, great-grandmother, whatever family member, on a piece of paper write date, who you spoke with, and what the conversation was about. It's even better if you take a little recorder with you and record the conversation. I am so happy and glad that I recorded my father's voice before he died. Because every now and then I go back and listen to it because I like hearing his voice. Become familiar with U.S. and African American history. Now I know for some of you that's going to sound like homework. When I was 16, 17, it probably would have sounded like homework for me too. But once I got linked into wanting to trace my family history, oh, it became, I went crazy. I had to learn more. Could I get you, Mr. Shabazz, to go to that page on Word, the timeline? Okay. It should be open. I think it's called African American History Timeline.
No, I gotta go back to the documents.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Oh, Stonewall, right?
Mm-hmm.
Wait.
No, yes, that might go. Yes. If you want to learn about your family history, you have to be aware of American history and African American history. But why? Why do I need to learn African American history and history, period? Well, could you scroll down some, Mr. Shabazz? Right, just a little bit further, just right there. Well, if I'm an African American, which I am, and I'm going to research my family history, you know, I need to know something about the first African Americans coming to this country in 1619. And I say country, but it's actually a colony at the time. Scroll down a little further, please. Okay. And for me, since my family lines go through Richmond, I need to know a little bit about what was going on in Richmond. Gabriel Prosser. Somebody read 1800 Gabriel Prosser, please. That means I need a volunteer. Oh, please, read Gabriel Prosser, 1800.
Gabriel Prosser, an enslaved African-American blacksmith, organized a slave revolt in Richmond, Virginia. Two slaves told of the coming revolt and the conspiracy was uncovered. Prosser and more than 20 of his followers were hanged, and as a result, Virginia's slave laws are tightened.
Now, where this took place, where that revolt took place, is less than three miles from where my father's father, my father's father, and my father's grandfather lived. So it raises questions for me. Oh, by the way, to give you some time frames. So my father's grandfather would have lived just about during that time. So it raises questions for me about, did my great-grandfather, was he aware of this? Did he hear about this uprising? Was he possibly a part of the uprising? Researching the information, and I'm going to show you a little bit more about researching as we go through, will help you answer some of those questions. Let's do one more if you could scroll down. So you do have to know your history. Let's see. Yes, sir, excuse me. Harriet Tubman. Somebody read Harriet Tubman, please, 1849. All of you heard of Harriet Tubman.
Harriet Tubman escaped from slavery and helped more than 300 sailors to freedom.
Yes. 1849. My father's, hang with me on this, this is going to go back a little bit. My father's father, okay, let's start there. So that would be my grandfather. My father's father's grandmother, still with me? Was born, her name is Elizabeth Wilson. She was born in 1830 in Richmond. So she would have been 19 years old at the time. My mind just goes all over the place with questions about, was she aware of the slaves being freed? Oh, by the way, interesting point, and it's something to take note of. Elizabeth Wilson, 1830, she was a free black woman living in Richmond, Virginia. There were pockets of free slaves. Oftentimes we only hear about enslaved folks, but there were absolutely folks who were free. So, yes, sir, you can go back to the website. We're going to talk a little bit more about the history. As I said a few minutes ago, make sure you talk to your family members about the history. And I want to cover a point here. Not so long ago, last year, maybe year before last, I was asked to talk about my family history on NPR radio. Any of you ever heard of NPR radio? Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. NPR radio. And I did a broadcast on my family. If you ever want to listen to it, just type in Percy White, type in NPR and Percy White at Google and you'll see the story. But the story was about my family, my parents. My father and mother were sharecroppers. Somebody tell me what a sharecropper is. Yes. Very good. How about when it came to the prophets?
They didn't make any right?
Actually, you're a very sharp young man. Yes, you said it very well. Before I go on to tell you the story, sharecropping was a system set up where a person, let's say you own land. I would come to you and you would say, okay, Mr. White, Percy, I'm going to give you, let you live on my land. We're going to share in the work and we're going to share in the profits. By the time the crops came in, or the land was worked, and you were ready to go to market to get paid, oftentimes you as a land owner would say, well, Percy, let's see, that seed that I had to buy, you know, I got to subtract that from what I owe you. That axe you broke when you were chopping down that tree for me, you broke the axe, I got to subtract that. The gas you use in that tractor, I got to take that away. By the time all of those things were taken away, you were left with virtually nothing. That's the story my father told me and I shared with NPR. You can learn about your family, your history, by doing a DNA test. Now, I think you might have to be 18. I was telling two young ladies, you might have to go through your parents. I got to read that information. I don't remember. But check with your parents first. But if you do the test or have somebody in your family do the test, little science quiz here. We're looking at chromosomes, okay? Men have XX, women have what?
Women have XX, men have XY.
Thank you, somebody caught me, I messed up, excuse me. Men have XY, women have? Thank you, she straightened me out, I almost forgot. So, I did a DNA test for my father, because only I could do the Y chromosome. Why could I only do the Y chromosome?
You have any sisters?
Hmm?
You only have sisters.
Right, so why couldn't they do the male one?
Because they don't have the male gene.
Very good. I know this sounds obvious, but sometimes folks didn't quite understand. I appreciate you spelling that out. So when I took the DNA test, I found out that Y chromosome passed from great-great-great-great-grandfather to great-great-great-grandfather to great-great-grandfather to great-grandfather to grandfather to father to me. The line goes back to the God people of West Africa. When I saw Mr. Shabazz here, he has on West African Ndinkra symbols. Those symbols represented certain things for a group of folks. Those symbols are important to me too. Mr. Shabazz, can I get you to go to the home page, please, for a second?
Absolutely.
And I get you to scroll down. I try to pronounce this, I always struggle. N Kong Song Kong Song. And Sankofa. Can you scroll down a little more, please? Somebody read to me what those two symbols mean. Anybody? I know that's a tough word.
Represents unity and human relations. And
okay, how about the next one?
Sankofa symbolizes the importance of learning from the past.
Yes. So by putting those there on the website, that was kind of my way of, again, remembering my father and his father and his father's father and generations that I've never seen. So, DNA tests. When you do DNA tests, you're going to find information that you may not have been aware of. On one DNA, let me give you a list of some of the DNA tests. One is 23andMe. Another is Ancestry.com. AfricanAncestry.com. DNA Tribes. and FamilyTreeDNA.com. If you're going to do them, start with 23andMe for a couple of reasons. One, 23andMe is only $99. The others can be very expensive. African Ancestry.
$300.
Exactly. And I split $300. And I split that cost between myself and my sister. And we did the same thing when we traced my mother's side, and I split the cost with them. So you do 23andMe first, because it's $99. Also, that will tell you where your family lineage is. What I mean by that is, for me, it would tell me the bulk of my family background was in Africa. There was a small percent, there was a 15% in Central Europe. Family history goes that we are part Cherokee Indian. That was passed down from my father. After we did the test, there was 0.100% of Native American. I tell you that last part to tell you that you that's kind of a connection to what we've already talked about. Talk to your family, find out the histories, but as you go along, just keep them in mind, because you kind of have to balance them against the information you find out. Testing DNA can yield, well, I already talked about that, okay. You know, check your family Bibles, visit churches. My father's grandmother lived in a place called Jackson Ward, Richmond. That is a historic area where African Americans just kind of populated where they lived, had their own businesses, churches, doctors, lawyers. Well, when I found out where she lived, and I found out where she lived from a census record, and I'm going to show you some of those in just a second. The census record said that she lived in Jackson Ward off of St. James Street. Well, I was trying to figure out, well, where do I go next in my search? I'm sure she attended church, but where? Let me ask you something. This is 1900, so she was 20 at the time. 1900, so I'm going to ask you to transport yourselves back to 1900, if you can imagine Richmond, Virginia. Did she catch a cab to a church 15, 20 miles away? No. Did she catch a bus to a church 15, 20 miles away? No. Do you think she might have walked 2.5 blocks to a church? Me too. So I looked at a map to see what churches were close by. 6th Mount Zion Baptist Church, roughly 2.5 blocks. I go to the church, great, they have a historian. And not only do they have a historian, but the church has kept records for the last almost 200 years. Since its existence, it's a very old church. We flip through the documents, and I see my father's grandmother, Cora B. Miles. She was a member of the church, paid dues, helped establish they have a small church museum. She helped establish that. That was great. That opened up more documents for me to keep going back and searching my family history. A quick story about Cora B. Miles. Hang with me on my family line. You will find out this information and much more about your own families as you research this information. Cora B. Miles had one child. That one child was Percy White Sr., my grandfather. You with me?
Yes.
Okay. Percy White Sr. married Alice, I'm forgetting my grandmother's name. Alice Rooney, excuse me. Married Alice Rooney. When Percy White marries Alice Rooney, Cora B. Miles wasn't all that crazy about that. She didn't particularly like Alice. So as the years go by, one day, my grandmother, Alice, is in the house in Richmond. I know this story because my uncle shared it with me. She's in the house cooking some stew, something in a pot. Cora B. Miles walks in, just walks in the house, doesn't knock, just comes in and opens up the pot and just starts looking in her pot. That angered my grandmother. And keep in mind, these two didn't really, there was no love lost between these two. They didn't particularly care for each other. So after Cora B. Miles left, my grandmother threw the food out and she took flour. Everybody know what flour is? Yeah. Something you cook with? She took flour and spread it all along the edge of the kitchen that she had come into. Somebody tell me why you think she did that. Say it again. Say it a little louder. Not exactly that she thought she was dirty, not in the sense of dirt. That's exactly what she was doing. My uncle shared with me, my uncle meaning Alice's son, because he was there at the time, she was trying to get rid of the evil. Cora B. Miles, in my grandmother's eyes, was seen as evil. Yes, yes. Now, I have yet to find out the history of how this has been passed down. I don't know if this was something my grandmother, Alice, learned from her mother. Well, keep in mind, Roots wouldn't have been out at the time.
I'm sorry, misunderstood.
Right, yes. It could very well have been an African trait passed down over the years. So that was one of the stories I found interesting. So, okay, so we do the DNA. We check the family Bibles. Find out how your family interacted with record-keeping organizations, like the federal government. Oh, yes, sir, please.
I just wanted to know the significance of checking in the family Bibles. What exactly would they be looking for?
Thank you. When you look at a little bit of history here, black folks formerly enslaved after 1865, slavery ended in 1865. There was an organization set up after 1865 known as the Freedmen's Bureau. The Freedmen's Bureau was put into place so as to legitimize marriages, because oftentimes a marriage would be simply the owner of the enslaved folks saying you're married, to help them own property, to set up a little banking system. But we didn't really have safe deposit boxes. We didn't have many of us, shortly after the end of the Civil War, 1865, didn't even have a home. You know, right after the end of the Civil War, there were formerly enslaved folks just walking up and down roads. They were asking, trying to locate their family members, but going back. So they didn't have a lot of places to keep documents. So as you were able to get a little money from working, selling, doing something, one of the first things folks often did was to buy a Bible. That Bible became the storage place for family history information. If you open up my parents' Bible, you will see locks of hair. You will see a yen, which is a form of money my father brought back from World War II. You will see documents about birth, marriage, death. The Bible is oftentimes a warehouse of information. I hope I answered that okay, Mr. Bunn. Okay. Yes, so that's why you should look at the family Bibles. Again, find out how your family interacted with state, federal, local agencies. For example, did they own land? If they own land, they pay taxes. There was a record created. Was there a question? Oh, I'm sorry. Were you asking a question or just moving in?
No.
Oh, okay. Percy White Sr., the gentleman I keep talking about, the one that's 6'9". Oh, I'm sorry, I keep moving. How did he interact with record-keeping agencies? Well, in 1918, remember he's born 1900. In 1918, how old would he be?
18.
As an 18-year-old, what do males have to do? Register for the Selective Service. In September of 1918, Percy White Sr. went to the armory Because he had to register for the Selective Service. How do I know that? Because through researching, and I'm going to give you the websites to use for this, I see a copy of his World War I registration card. World War I. We don't have to pull it back up. But then again, you have to know your history. Somebody tell me, what was going on in World War I? Somebody, what was World War I about? Ooh, I hear silence.
Alliances.
Who were the folks participating in World War I? Both of the countries. Let's start there. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Somebody fairly close to where you are now got involved. Yes, very good, very good. And the United States got involved.
They left Germany broke.
Say it again?
They left Germany broke.
They left Germany broke? Okay.
And they have to pay to restore like Europe. Yeah, like
very good. And my point here was just to say, I could just say, great, he registered for World War I, but why? Why would he have to do that? What was going on at that time in 1918? I mean, that's not a question to be answered, but I'm just saying, these are things you should ask yourself if you have an interest in going back, and I hope you will gather an interest. I hope I can, again, I'm able to spark something. Consider purchasing a camera or a laptop, and that's how you can keep track of your information. Some of the websites that you should use include. How many of you have heard of Ancestry.com? Should be all of you. I've seen them on TV like 3 or 4 times a day. Great website. Great, great, great. Costs like $150, $175 for a year. It's not cheap. There's a website that's getting just as good, and it's 100% free. It is called Family Search. FamilySearch.com. I'm not promoting anything other than to say this is a useful resource. This is a database that's run by the Mormons, the Latter-day Saints. They do this because they see it as being important to share this information with the population. I found great records using Family Search. Again, 100% free. Another resource. Use my website. I want to show you. Mr. Shabazz, can I get you to go up for a second? Go to family viewers, viewers families, I'm sorry. And scroll down. I've tried to compile, I'm not ancestry.com, nowhere near that big. I've tried to compile some information for folks to use as well. That's my grandmother, Grandmother Alice's grandmother, mother, and that's my mother's father, Arthur Wright and Miss Rooney. But if you could click on UVWX, scroll down, please. I've created, these are pictures that viewers sent in and I put them on the site. That can be a resource. Some of the biggest resources, I cannot say this enough, is your family. Talk to them. Talk to them. Can I get you to go back to the, back up top please, Mr. Shabazz?
Yes.
Now, yes, did I have a question? You said that he had all of these kids? Absolutely. 2, 4, 6, 8. That's really not that many for that time. That's not that many. Yes, sir. Can I go all the way to the top and click on men, please? And then civil rights, which is in the red down there in the book. And then if you would scroll down, please, to... Emmett Till. Mm-hmm. It should be enough. Yes, not political order. Keep going down, please. Yes. My father was born in 1925, so in 1955, he was a young man. This is how, again, how I got connected into history and into family history. That event, to say it shocked my father would be an understatement. Who knows the story of Emmett Till? Few people? Okay. I'm going to let, who would like to read? I'm going to get somebody. Could you scroll down, please? I don't think it's too long. That's not that long. Come on, somebody read, please. Anybody? Say it again. Yes, one paragraph at a time. Yeah. Okay. I need you to read loud enough, though, because...
Disrespecting a white woman. Emmett grew up in Chicago and was sent by his mother, Mamie Till, to spend the summer of 1955 with his cousins in Great Lake Road, Chicago.
Can anybody read the next one? Yes, ma'am.
Okay. On August 24th, 1955, Emmett and his cousin, Wheeler, walked into Bryant's store to buy some food needs and soda. Wheeler had made his purchase, walked out, and it was in the store a short time before his cousin Simeon
mm-hmm.
went to check on him and paid for his items, and the two of them left the store. Carolyn Bryant called her at the store, came up behind them, walking in the direction of her car. That's when Emmett whistled at her. Several days later, Carolyn's husband, Roy Bryant, and brother J.W. William kidnapped Emmett in the middle of the night from his great uncles and drove him to the farm where they tortured and beat him to death.
Okay. You want to read?
Yeah.
What do you have questions?
No.
Okay, please do. Yes. I need you to read a little bit louder.
When Emmett's archery and Summer's body was found in the Tallahatchie River, he had been beaten, shot in the head, and a 75-pound cotton gin fan was tied around his neck with barbed wire on September 22nd, 1955. Jet Magazine published an article which included horrific pictures of Emmett beaten in his figure body. The story was seen by thousands of people and is believed to have been the catalyst for the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s.
Okay, and I'll read the last paragraph. Bryant and Milam were charged with murder. The trial was held at Tallahatchie Courthouse in Sumner, Mississippi. The case lasted from September 19th to September 23rd of 1955. Both men were found not guilty by an all-white male jury in an article published in January of 1956 in Look magazine. Bryant and Milam admitted to killing Emmett. They were paid $4,000 for their story. And scroll up if you would, Mr. Shabazz. Okay. These are pictures related to this. Everything you see on my website, I went to every place, I spoke to folks, I took the pictures, especially the Money, Mississippi, because I got to go back to this story in reference to my father and family history. This story was of tremendous impact on my father. It scared him. Now, he never said it scared him, but I know it did. How do I know that? He told me this story several times throughout my life, and he told it to me in his attempt to try to keep me safe. These are the pictures of Emmett Till. That's what's left of the store, Bryant's store. That's the courthouse. That's where the funeral was held in Chicago. I have a pointer here somewhere.
Wait, I'm sorry, what did you say this was right here?
That's Bryant's store.
That's the store.
That's the actual store where he was accused of whistling at Carolyn Bryant. And that's the store there too.
This one?
Yes, sir. And that's the courthouse where the trial is held. Let's go back to something that I said okay, I'm gonna get to your question in just a second. Don't forget it though. You saw me put by all white male jury. Let me tell you why that was there. In Sumner, Mississippi in 1955, black folks were not allowed to vote. Okay? If you can't vote, you don't get to be a juror. Because the records they use to pull jurors, people to sit on a jury, comes from voting records. So that's why it ended up being, this is my opinion, let me qualify that, why it became an all-white male jury. And by the way, if you ever look at the documentary, PBS runs it from time to time, you can hear the men saying that they took like an hour, and because they wanted to make it look good as they deliberated, as they went back to so-called deliberate to decide what should happen to those men. And they said it wouldn't have taken that long if they didn't stop to get some soda. Yes, sir, you have a question. And then you may have a question. Yes, sir? Say that one more time. Great question. I was just there in October of this year. That building is still standing. Just the way it looks now. Oh, I'm sorry, excuse me. Mr. Shabazz, click on, all of these pictures are clickable. Click on the one of the other store. No, ma'am, and it's not used for anything, and this is why. You can't see it, but you can barely see it. There's a house back there. A gentleman owns that property. Oh, by the way, from here back is private property. Right there says trespassing, so I made sure never to cross that line. the gentleman that owns that, I was told he wants six figures for that property because a lot of people have inquired about buying it and turning it into a national historic site. So he wants $1 million+, and folks were not willing to pay that. Yes, ma'am, of course.
Was there a sense of outrage when this actually took place among good folk in America? Or was it like sort of just, it was just the way it was? Were people outraged by it?
Great question. People were extremely outraged. Can I get you to close, hit that X right there? Yes, the top X, the red. I'm sorry, up in the, oh, you know what? Y'all have a, there you go. Yes, sir. That picture there appeared in Jet Magazine. When it did, it outraged the country, and that story was spread across the world. There were protests. There were protests from people of all colors, countries in Europe, in Africa, of course in the United States. There were marches in protest of this, because the question became, how could this little 14, oh, by the way, I'm sorry, I think he said in the story, he was 14 at the time, Emmett Till, when he was killed. Say it again? Another very good point. His mother wanted an open casket. I am a big, strong guy and can lift a lot of weight, but I do not have the strength that Mamie Till had when she said to the undertaker, no, do not close the casket on my son. I want the world to see what they did to my son. I can only imagine the strength it took for that, a mother to allow the world to look at what they did to her son. Yes, sir.
The people that killed him, I know that because of double jeopardy, they couldn't try them again after they admitted it.
Exactly. But
what did the people of that town, like I guess the black people of that town, do when they didn't do it? They got paid to.
Great question. Great, great question. And I want to repeat it. What did the black people of that town do after that happened? Remember Mose Wright, his uncle?
Yeah.
In that story? Mose Wright got up on the stand and had to identify the two men that came knocking on the door that night to come get Emmett out the house. So there's a picture, I have it up in my house, of Mose Wright pointing, on the, he's sitting on the stand, pointing, saying, there he,
Darby.
Exactly,
Darby.
Of those two men, Bryant and Milam. After he testified, when he walked out of that courthouse, he got on, got in the car, went to the train station, and headed north to Chicago. One of the other men that testified, Wheeler. Wheeler testified, and right after he did the same thing. Somebody tell me why they got out of town. Exactly. Let's see if we can transport you back for a minute. Hopefully I can set the environment, set the picture. This is 1955, Money, Mississippi. Let me tell you how big Money, Mississippi is, and I am not going to exaggerate. No exaggerations, I've been there several times. This is King Street, right? One house here, the store, excuse me, here, one little house behind it, and this is the road. Okay, so I'm standing here looking at Bryant's store right here with the little house behind it. Behind me is a railroad track and the Mississippi Delta, which means flat, wide open land, and you don't see anything other than maybe a mile or two back trees. Maybe there was another home back there, I don't remember seeing one. This was an all-white, majority white area. The blacks that lived in that area at that time could not vote. They could not sit on juries. There was no law that a black person had, no right that a black person had that had to be respected by a white person. In the documentary in reference to Emmett Till, one of the gentlemen talks about one of the women who grew up there talked about when men walk down the street, black men, if they see a white person coming toward them, they had to get out the way, off the street, let that person pass, bow their head, and didn't say a thing, and just let that person pass. After that person passed, then they could get back on the street and walk. It was a life of where African Americans had very little rights. So in Money, Mississippi in 1955, I'm sorry, Bishop, I was going to say something.
No, I was angry, I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
I went somewhere else, I'm sorry, I'm with you.
So, okay, I'm gonna come to you. So keep that in your picture, in your mind as you picture Money, Mississippi. The only jobs that blacks had were laborers, farmhands, or domestics. What's a domestic?
Animals.
That is the way the term domestic is used, but no. Yes. Bingo. My 102-year-old grandmother, when she came up here from Emporia, Virginia in 1952, the job she had from 1952 until she retired like in 2000 and something was as a domestic. A lot of the clothes we got came from clothes that were passed down that she got from the people she worked for that she would bring home to her family. But anyway, yes, so those are the only jobs available. So the life you experience now, this is not the way things were in 1955. So if whites wanted to go to somebody's door and say, give me that boy, I'm taking them with me, they could, and they did, as they did with Emmett Till. You have a question, I'm sorry.
I just want to know, why were they like that?
Wow. Major, major questions. Why was it like that? Where did slavery come from? Where did it begin? That is like a four college course class. I'm going to abbreviate it to the best of my ability. Where did it come from? There has always been slavery, unfortunately, throughout the world. However, there have been different forms of slavery. The United States practiced a form of slavery called chattel slavery. You will often hear that, hey, wait a minute, Africans had slaves too. And you know, and they sold them to other people. That's true. However, different form of slavery, let me tell you why. The Africans, let's say if they took people as a slave, that enslaved person could be actually marry other folks, become a part of the society, become a part of the group that had enslaved them. Now, granted, yes, they were still enslaved, but that's tremendously different than the system that was placed here in the United States, where you become a slave, you virtually end up having no rights. In answer to your question, we're going to go to a different screen, because let's see if I can answer. Can I get you to go to the top, please?
Absolutely.
Can I get you to go to women? Always at the top. I'm sorry. Go to women. And this is civil rights. And scroll down, please. Yes, sir, you keep going. And we're going to the, you keep going. Mm-hmm, you keep going. Mm-hmm. Right, oh, I'm sorry, right there. Go back up, please. Right here, and I'm going to read from here. This is an answer to your question. Virginia has a history of laws against, this was in reference to the Lovings. The Lovings were an interracial couple who prior to 1967 chose to get married, but it was against the law in Virginia. But this is to answer your question. Virginia has a history of laws against interracial marriage and miscegenation. Miscegenation is this big word they use for years ago, what they call race mixing. It's not a term that's used much anymore. That date back to colonial times. In 1607, English settlers established Jamestown, Virginia. In that same year, Dutch mariners traded 20 Africans stolen from a Spanish ship to the colonists for food. On June 30th, 1619, Virginia's first governing body, the Virginia Assembly, was established and convened in 1630. The first reference to blacks appeared in Virginia law records. On September 17, 1630, the Assembly passed the following legislation. Hugh Davis to be soundly whipped before an assembly of Negroes and others for abusing himself to the dishonor of God and shame of Christians by defiling his body and lying with a Negro, which fault he is to acknowledge next Sabbath day. So very early on, and I'm going to continue reading that, very early on in our history, people of African descent were not seen as equal. They were seen as a labor force, a way to make money. Blacks were whipped or banished from the colony for marrying or having sex while a person in 1640, having sex with a white person. In 1640, a white man had sex with a black woman and was ordered to confess his sins in church. The black woman received harsher punishment. This is the statement here. Robert Sweet to do penance in church according to the laws of England. Penance is like going in front of the church, standing here, and kind of confessing your sins. Robert Sweet to do penance in church according to the laws of England for getting a Negro woman and child, with child, for getting a Negro woman with a child. And the woman whipped. Long time ago, they didn't say pregnant, so woman with child means he got her pregnant. In 1691, Virginia Law Act 16 specifically prohibited interbreeding or intermarriage between whites and non-whites. If a free white married a Negro, mulatto, or Indian, mulatto was a term used for a black person, for a person having a percentage of African blood in their system. This was outrageous because it went so far as to do one drop. So it would start as, I think I remember the terms, a quadroon. Quadroon was meant like one fourth. Octodroon, meaning I had one eighth African descent. And it would go on. Mulatto or Indian, they were permanently banished from the colony and had to leave within 3 months from the date of their marriage. If a free, unmarried white woman gave birth to a mulatto child, she was fined 15 pounds to be paid to the church wardens. The child born from their union was ordered to work as a servant until his or her 30th birthday. The Virginia Assembly fashioned laws regarding white women giving birth to a mulatto children in such a way as to not increase the free black population. The early colonists were concerned. Whoa, hold up here. We can't have the black folks outnumbering us. So there's something called a slave schedule, which lists your property. So you would see Mr. Johnson owns 4 cows, 3 pigs, 6 horses, 3 Negro males, 3 Negro females. That's how we were listed. If there was a name attached to that record, wow, I'm in heaven. Because oftentimes there were no names attached to it. If it's a name attached to it, it gives me that much more ability to continue to go back during the research. Even if you don't have a name, you can still do it, but it becomes very tough. Because then you have to look at, you have to connect your family member with being on that plantation. Sometimes the formerly enslaved would take the names of the slave owners. Sometimes they wouldn't. After the Civil War, when folks were freed, some black folks said, no, I'm naming myself something totally different. They wanted no connection with that which they had gone through. Oh, yes, sir.
No, I just wanted to make note. There's a text, Black Family and Slavery and Freedom. It's a very famous history book. But basically, it talks about how if you meet someone named Freeman today, there are a lot of blacks who, right after the Civil War, rather than to continue to have the slave master's name, they would literally change their last name to Freeman. And that's, and so a lot of the people that you know named Freeman, it was as a result of the end of the Civil War when they were throwing off the mental slavery here and decided they didn't want to maintain those names.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Shabazz. And even though this is history, but, okay, I'm coming to you, don't forget your question. This is history, but this is your history. This is all of our histories. And tracing your family history, you might find connections to historical events, to historical people. I'm not guaranteeing that, but what you will find reference to are the people who came before you who made it so that you can be here. Now, y'all can't see this, but there are more than 300, actually, way more than 300, more like 3,000. Actually, way more than 3,000. There are thousands of people standing up here with me right now. Thousands who made it so that I can be here. Now, this isn't me, I'm not special. The same applies to you. Who are those folks from who you descend? Who are those folks that you get your hair color from, your eye color, your height? Who are those folks? Yes, ma'am.
I have two.
2 questions, good. Excuse me just for a second. Did I come close to answering your question?
Yeah.
Okay, great question.
The question was from the tail. He got the chocolate from Wilson.
Yes.
Okay. Last year I went to HBCU college store, and we went to Alabama State, and we visited the museum in Alabama, and I forgot the museum, so I was really interested. And this man was talking to us about Emmett Till, and he said they didn't really know what he did. They said he had speech problems, and he came out as a Wilson. Like, they, basically they're saying that he really didn't get caught with Wilson. He wasn't Wilson after the way he was Wilson to himself. Like, is that true? Like, he didn't really know what he did?
You are very intelligent, young lady. There are many books, many articles that have been written about what Emmett Till actually did. First of all, he did have a stutter. His mother, Mamie Till, said he did stutter. He did. She also said he was a playful kid. You know, he was a jokester. His buddy said that he was a jokester. It kind of depends who you choose to believe. I go by Simeon Wright, his cousin, who went in the store with him, who went in the store after him to make sure he was fine and came out with him. Simeon said that he whistled at her. Other accounts that you may hear is that Emmett Till brushed against her hand when she was giving him the change, that while she was giving him his change, he said, hey baby. There are other accounts, several different accounts, but that's a good question. It's not uncommon that you would hear different things about what he had done. Wow, that's a pretty powerful question. I'm never emotionally attached. I'm human like everybody in this room. When I read those things, it hits me and it hits me hard. Especially when the connection is made through my family. Because I go back to my father. My father was the one that told me the story of Emmett Till. And I know how it impacted him. I know how it impacted me. Today, y'all have your own stories that you'll be passing down to your kids, grandkids, relatives, and so forth. Trayvon Martin. There'll be other stories. But yes, I am impacted. And sometimes when I try to pause, when I do pause and kind of take a deep breath, I find myself, I'd be lying to if I told you otherwise, very angry. But the way I let go of the anger is to learn as much as I can about history, the history I come from, and the people who make it, so that I can stand here in front of you. Yes, sir.
What is,
excuse me, how am I doing on time? Am I okay?
About 9 minutes.
9 minutes? Okay, in a minute, I'm going to go to just open up the questions. Oh, one more thing before that, but go ahead. I'll do one more thing before questions.
Because I feel like these websites that Black family use American records. So what I feel is, like, what I'm saying is, like, what if you don't have records of any family members that aren't your parents? Because all of my family in this country is just my parents. You know what I'm saying? So, like,
I do.
Would that find
family roots?
Yeah, like, would it go back that far to other countries and things like that? Like, how would they even be able to look at that?
To go back? Find family roots in my, keep in mind, that's my website. I'm smaller.
3 minutes.
Okay, well, I'll be faster. But, for example, Ancestry.com, which is a big website, they not only have records for the United States, but they have international records for other countries. And the folks who were not born or their immediate family, grandparents, so forth, may have come from another country, that's not impossible to research. There were many Americans who came into the United States through New York. There's an island up in New York, area, it's called Ellis Island. Many of the, they refer to them as immigrants. Came in through Ellis Island. Another major port was Philadelphia. Another port from that was Baltimore. Before I absolutely close out, could I get you scrolled one more time? I heard young ladies who were here talk about something, and I just kind of want to end on this note. Ooh, that's their bell? Oh, okay, then I guess I got to end.